ready? Ça fonctionne. Mesdames et messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, Your Excellencies. Herzlich willkommen zu dieser Veranstaltung 20 on 2020. Bevor wir seine Exzellenz Herrn Dion, Botschafter von Kanada in Deutschland und Sonderbotschafter für die Europäische Union und Europa für seine Eröffnungsrede begrüßen, es ist mir eine große Ehre, die SchriftstellerInnen für diese Veranstaltung vorzustellen. From Canada, Kim Thuy. Born in Vietnam, settling in Canada as a child refugee, Kim Thuy's life has been marked by resilience and survival, and a lot of happiness too. She was a lawyer, a restaurant owner, and is now an accomplished writer. Her first novel, Rue, won the Governor General's Award for French language fiction. Her other work has also received many nominations and awards. Also from Canada, Blaise Ndala, bienvenue. Né en République démocratique du Congo, il a quitté la Belgique pour s'installer au Canada. When he's not practicing law in Ottawa, he's busy putting pen to paper, creating novels that conjure up images and generate discussion. They include Sans Capote ni Kalashnikov, which has won acclaim and numerous awards. And from Germany, Simone Buchholz, born in Hanau, and she's been a waitress, journalist, and columnist. She's written numerous books and won many awards, including the Crime Cologne Award and the German Crime Fiction Prize. In 2016, she was awarded the Crime Cologne Award for Blue Night, which was number one on the Krimi Zeit Best of Crime list, for months. Et pour terminer, permettez-moi de remercier mes collègues de l'ambassade d'Allemagne à Ottawa, de Simon Schuster et du Goethe Institute. Without you, this journey, and you know it, would not have been possible. It has been a beautiful one. Thank you very much. Ambassadeur Dion, s'il vous plaît.
Mesdames et messieurs, bienvenue au pavillon du Canada pour cette table ronde qui va être certainement très captivante. My job is very simple, is to answer some questions. First question is what? What will we discuss? A book. What else? And at the book fair. A book. The title is 20 of 2020. So the concept of the book is 10 German writers and 10 Canadian writers writing, each of them, a story linked to their experience of the pandemic. And I think it's a very good idea, because around the world, when people were in isolation, en quarantaine, c'est le même mot en anglais, quarantine, and en allemand, quarantaine. But it's the same reality that may be very, very difficult. How many lives have been saved because people were able to not be in isolation because they were with a novel, with a story, with a dream. So I think it's a great idea. So who are these authors? Some of them are with us. Et merci beaucoup pour cela. Merci Kim Thuy, liebe Simone Buchholz et cher Blaise Ndala. Merci beaucoup. On va avoir beaucoup d'intérêt à vous entendre. So that's the what and the who. But thanks to whom? Who had this idea? Well, it is Sabine Sparwasser, the ambassador of Germany in Ottawa. I think we want to thank you, Sabine, for that. And thanks to who? It would not have been possible without a publisher. Any good idea, if you don't have a publisher, cannot publish. So I want to thank a lot President Kevin Hansen. Thank you very much to you. thank you for everything you have done, and to the and to Simon and Schuster, thank you to make this dream true. We have this book thanks to you. And my the last question I need to answer, it is, who will be sitting on this chair to animate this round table? And well, it is ce monsieur qui accompagne la gouverneure générale du Canada, Mary May Simon. Et ce monsieur, so let me talk a bit about him. He's a storyteller, so it's very good. It's very good that we'll have to animate this roundtable a storyteller. So Your Excellency, Whit Fraser, you will have this responsibility to make sure that they will not speak all together, but one after the other one. And they will listen to each other, I'm sure they will. So why are you a storyteller? Because you had the, we are very privileged that your story are a lot about Canada, a lot about the Arctic, a lot about the North, a lot about the beauty of this part of the world, a lot about the people that live there, and you have expressed that with so much truth and veracity and emotion that I'm sure you will be a great moderator and participant to this event. And to be sure that I will have all the time to benefit from it, I stop here. J'ai dit ce que j'avais à dire, j'ai présenté ce que j'avais à présenter, et j'ai très hâte, comme vous toutes et tous, d'écouter ce qui va se dire maintenant. Dankeschön. Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much.
Months, mask on, mask off, mask on, mask off. Thank you very much, Ambassador Dionne. Over the past 48 hours, I've heard you mention many times about the Frankfurt Book Fair and how it's Canada's second year because of COVID. And it occurred to me that every great book needs to be read at least twice. And Canada is a great book. It still has thousands of pages of untold stories, but it is a great book, and it deserves to be read twice as well. So thank you, Ambassador. I suppose what better way to start a panel on a major book fair is with a little plagiarizing. "It was the best of times and the worst of times," said Charles Dickens. And I think we can all identify with it. The best of times and the worst of times. For myself and for my wife, it was mixed times. There were blessings. There are days where you could go were the best days that we've had in many, many years. And then only to be at nighttime brought to reality with the images of big cities unable to handle the dead and the old people in dying in seniors' homes in small towns. So like everybody, we're ripped apart by it. I did want to mention, before I put the first question, you mentioned, Ambassador, my own background. I started as a storyteller and a broadcaster many years ago in the North, and someone asked me the other day, what was the best story you've ever covered? And the best story I ever covered lasted about 30 years. It was the beginning of the Indigenous rights movement when young, then called radical Aboriginal and Indigenous Canadians began asserting their rights and putting an end to colonialism. And the last story I covered as a broadcaster was the creation of Nunavut in 1999. So that was the best story I ever covered, and I knew all along that I was covering the best story in Canada, the growth of the North. And yes, I wrote about it, and I wrote about those young people who are now today's elderly, today's statesmen and women. And I also know that I'm here, not as a budding 79-year-old journalist, but simply because I married well. But either way, I'm glad to be here, and I'm glad to be with all of you. So I want to say to our panelists to consider for a moment, and they've all likely been in this position as I have, there you are in front of a publisher, and you know you have a minute, and you have to make your pitch. So on your essay, make your pitch to all of these publishers and to what you wrote.
We love the elevator pitch.
I'll begin with Kim.
Oh, about the text that I wrote with the 2020? Yeah, 1 minute? I don't know how to do this, but it was exciting because, you know, to feel that you have other authors working at the same time. So I just wanted to be part of a family of authors, I think. And I didn't know what you wanted. I just said yes. So that was my pitch. I say yes to anything and everything. And so that's it.
So. Oui. Alors dans mon cas, évidemment, j'ai reçu cette invitation à la fois avec surprise, mais également avec une dose de reconnaissance d'être invité dans une famille aussi grande de deux côtés de l'Atlantique. Après, je me suis posé la question, mais de quoi vais-je parler? Tout le monde est tellement gavé de cette histoire de pandémie. Que vais-je leur apporter de nouveau? Et puis, je me suis quand même rappelé que s'il y avait quelque chose qui m'avait secoué, mais alors secoué au plus profond de moi, au plus fort de la pandémie, c'était l'affaire George Floyd. Et comme tout le monde, à travers le monde, en tant que personne noire, ben, c'est là qu'il est allé me chercher vraiment dans ce qui me définissait le plus comme un être humain. À partir de là, je me suis dit peut-être qu'il y aurait lieu dans cet espace et dans ce qui allait précéder, matière à lancer un bout de ce qui me faisait me demander de ce que nous allions devenir dans quelques années si nous n'avions pas écouté la lame de fond qui s'était levé de Minneapolis à Dakar en passant par Rio de Janeiro. C'est un peu dans cet esprit que je me suis amusé à pondre ce texte pour qu'un jour nous puissions engager enfin ces histoires, that untold stories que vous avez mentionnées et qui doivent faire partie urgemment de la grande conversation universelle. C'est tout.
Simone, I'm sorry that you have to come after Blaise, okay? Because now I don't know what to say.
No problem.
Yeah, if I had to pitch my story to a publisher, I would just invite him to come to my home and to see my life as a working mom and then take out institutional childcare. And here we go. That's what the story is about.
The struggles of a working
mom. The struggle of working moms, if the ground on which you are standing with your whole life is just vanishing.
See, it strikes me that everybody over the past 20 months or so, it's how do you get trying to live a normal life and still get through this? And not be completely taken away with focus, to not let it knock you off your focus entirely. And Blaise, that's what you're saying, that you kept your focus throughout.
Je pense que je n'ai même pas eu le temps de me poser la question, en fait. En ce qui me concerne, cette pandémie est arrivée à un moment où un événement important survenait dans ma vie, à savoir la naissance de mon premier enfant. Je suis de ceux qui attendent très, très, très tard avant d'avoir des enfants. J'ai quitté le Congo en 2003 pour aller étudier en Belgique, comme tout Congolais qui se respecte. Et après, j'ai entendu l'appel du large, du multiculturalisme canadien qui me faisait de l'œil. Et je me suis dit, ben, l'enfant viendra, hein, quand on sera là-bas, quand on aura parcouru les plaines canadiennes et qu'on aura trouvé enfin la femme canadienne comme on l'aime. Et j'en ai trouvé une, by the way. Et enfin, l'enfant est venu, mais en pleine pandémie. Et est arrivée cette histoire choquante qui nous a tous bouleversés. Et du coup, oui, je me suis demandé dans quel monde allait vivre cet enfant métisse qui a une mère acadienne blanche et qui est né d'un père noir comme moi sur un continent où on le considéra toujours comme noir. Quel monde allons-nous lui léguer? Et c'est comme ça qu'entre cette interrogation criante qui m'habitait et la nécessité de coucher par écrit ce qui pourrait donner lieu, comme je le disais, à cette discussion nécessaire, que même nous au Canada, parfois, avons différé parce qu'on disait, nous ne sommes pas les États-Unis d'Amérique. Ça ne se passe pas ici. Mais si ça s'est passé ici quand, sans qu'on le voie ou sans qu'on le dise, qu'est-ce qui lui adviendrait? Quand on est habité par ce genre de questions, on ne s'interroge plus. Si on est écrivain, on fait ce qu'on a à faire. On prend sa plume et on sort ce qu'on a dedans et on met sur papier. C'était presque quelque chose de viscéral qui est sorti d'instinct sans que je me décide si je devais continuer à faire ma vie comme avant ou si je devais écrire quelque chose pour cette génération qui va arriver.
Vous savez, il y a, in English, right? There's a myth with the Vietnamese boat people, because there were many boats which, you know, after wreckages, you would find little babies, and people who didn't know how to swim, surviving the wreckage. You know, we find them on the beach, and so we started thinking that maybe life is about letting go, just following whatever comes to you. Because if you fight against the elements, you never win. The elements are always stronger than you. So you just let the waves take you. And usually it will take you to somewhere, to destination. And so the pandemic to me was about that. And we had that in us, or in my family anyway, that you just let yourself go. And normalcy is never normal for a long time. It changes all the time. So we just followed the wave. And I remember my mom, who was cutting cucumbers, I went to her and I said, well, you know, curfew starting tomorrow. And because we lived together in the same bubble. And she said, oh, no problem. We have enough food for a year, maybe, you know, in the basement. And I don't know how many freezers she has. And so she started telling the story that I didn't know. I learned it during the pandemic. That she delivered me during, you know, in Vietnam with curfews every day for the last whatever, you know, for 20 years. And so she said she went to the hospital really early so that she would avoid curfews. And I said, yeah, but the military would let you go to the hospital, right, to deliver. And she said, yes, of course, but you don't want to be outside during curfews with all the bullets going everywhere. So you go to the hospital earlier in the day. And then that reminded me that I was born with curfews. You know, I lived my first 10 years with curfews. And that's why I didn't react at all to curfews. I said, okay, no problem. You know, we have enough food, we have enough this and that. And so I think I had the chance to be trained, you know, to live with changes at the last minute or at any moment. It could happen at any moment. So that's why I think my text was very positive. That everything was fine for us, you know. So that was the privilege that we had been trained for this kind of catastrophe or this kind of change.
Were we ever ready? Was Germany ready for it? Were you ready for what was coming?
No, of course not.
No.
but I think I went through different, like, states of mind. And the first was really, I was so angry about the conservative structures in the country I'm living, but the society is so much more modern. So yeah, parents are all working, mothers are working, but the structures are not like made for this. And in the first time I was really angry. I felt like, oh my God, you're taking away my self-determination to be a working woman. But then I adjusted to the situation quite quickly. my son helped me a lot with that because he was 12 then, he's now 13, and this is the special age where people, like, you know, they're so fluid with their whole personality, and he adjusted very well to it. And he was like a role model for me, and he always came to me in the morning and said, "We're doing this together, Mom. I'm working, you're working, we're just doing this together." And from this moment on, I had also the feeling of being very privileged, of course, being in the center of Europe with a functioning health system, in a city with people who care about each other, and to quickly adjust it to this new body language of social distancing, which is difficult, you know, in a packed European city, like I'm living in Hamburg. It's crowded, the streets are narrow, and the people, I found it really kind of heartbreaking how the people always moved like this on the streets, just not to get in each other's way. And then I think it started like, yeah, last summer maybe, when I felt adjusted to the new normal. I felt, especially in this city where I live, which is a harbor city, a massive core of solidarity in the city society, where we just had the feeling of, okay, let's get through this all together and in our very privileged situation that we are.
In the 2020, there are essays from 10 Canadians, of course, 10 Germans. Was there one essay in there that each of you would have read and moved you in any way, emotionally, anger or inspiration?
It was, in fact, Amy Stewart, The Language of Spaces, if I remind it correctly now, because that was what I just was talking about. I found it so special and moving how we adjusted our body language to this new situation. And she describes it in a very, very fine way, how it feels to stand apart from each other, but because we don't want to hurt each other. And I found it difficult to do so. I found really like learning a new language suddenly if you're out on the streets. And what was really crazy, I don't know how it was in Canada, but in Germany, there was this joke, a drawing on Twitter, the path of the people through the cities, and the path of men were like straight, and the women were like walking like this the whole time. Which was really funny, and it was so German.
And probably so true.
I found it true, yeah. The first weeks I was just trying to get out of the way of men. In the end, I really appreciated how our minds and our bodies learned this new kind of language. I don't know if we are able to unlearn it again. I think something will stay. I was in Denmark, for example, 2 weeks ago, and it's the land without a pandemic. They just stopped it, and I didn't very well adjust to it, I have to say.
Kim?
I would say blessed, because just to rethink the world, you know, it's an opportunity for us to think of a world after this, and to question when we have children. And my children are also half-half, so I don't know what they look like. I think mostly they think that my children look like, people would say that they look like Mexican, or I don't know why. their father is from Lac Saint-Jean, up north, you know, like really, the Canadian, you know, Québécois, the Québécois, le plus Québécois, you know, as well, take a real one, right? You went for Acadienne, mm-hmm. and I went for Lac Saint-Jean, right? So as well. And we do, you know, the pandemic like you said, we think about our children, what's going to happen next for them in this world, with all the mix and match, I would say there are quite a few now. So maybe the next world will be really easier on them because of us going for Acadie and Lac Saint Jean.
Absolument. Alors, pour revenir à la question, back to your question, which one? I was struggling between two contributions, actually. Ah, mais il faut que je revienne en français, c'est ça le Canada aussi, n'est-ce pas, Monsieur Stéphane Dion? Hein? Et voilà, il est là. Alors, dans mon cas, je vais un peu tricher, hein, donc je vais prendre deux textes qui m'ont, pour des raisons différentes, vraiment marqué. Le premier, je vais peut-être mal prononcer son nom, c'est de Wiebke von Schottfeld, d'Allemagne. Elle a fait un texte qui s'appelle, dont le titre est 5690 kilomètres. Mm-hmm. 5960 kilomètres, something like that. Et ce qui m'a touché, c'est de voir à quel point elle, qui est d'origine allemande et qui vit au Canada, face à cette pandémie, s'est retrouvée pratiquement dans la même situation qui est la mienne à l'égard de la famille. Sa famille était restée en Allemagne, donc elle avait du mal à les revoir. Évidemment, comme tout le monde, elle ne pouvait pas bouger et s'inquiétait. Donc, ils ont essayé de développer des mécanismes au sein de la famille pour garder contact, continuer à se parler, parfois continuer à se voir. Et ça, c'était la réalité de beaucoup de gens qui vivent loin de leur, donc loin de leur pays. Dans mon cas, loin du Congo. Et j'ai deux parents qui sont quand même aujourd'hui relativement âgés. Juste avant la pandémie, mon père était allé se faire soigner en France, à Rouen, là où vit ma sœur. Il avait été opéré d'un début de cancer de la prostate. Et il était prévu qu'il revienne enfin en France pour ses examens. La pandémie nous a tous bloqués. Et malgré tous les moyens que j'avais réunis comme auteur et comme fonctionnaire à Ottawa pour l'aider à voyager, les moyens étaient là, mais ils ne pouvaient pas voyager. Donc on a dû jouer un peu ces systèmes. On a trouvé des solutions à Kinshasa, mais de vivre ces déchirements et de voir tout ce que je pouvais lui offrir comme soin et que je ne pouvais pas le faire en raison de la pandémie, ça m'a vraiment touché. D'autant plus que mon père est quelqu'un qui croit, comment dirais-je, qui presque sacralise l'Occident, je vais le dire comme ça. C'est un dessus de la dictature des années de Mobutu, hein, du temps du Zaïre. C'était un enseignant qui a été brimé sous Mobutu pour ses opinions politiques. Il a un regard extrêmement dur à l'égard des régimes africains en général. Moi, je lui dis toujours, papa, il faut leur donner du temps. Nous sommes des États jeunes. Si le Canada, qui a 200 ans, est un État jeune, alors imagine le Congo, 61 ans après l'indépendance. Il me dit, non, il ne faut pas comparer avec les Blancs. Les Blancs sont ailleurs. Et là, il y avait cette technologie, cette science, cette médecine des Blancs qui était à portée de main, mais il ne pouvait pas y accéder. Et lui, c'était vital, parce qu'il pourrait en mourir. Et dans les textes de Wiebke, donc je vois qu'elle, même si la vie n'était pas en jeu, elle s'est démenée aussi de loin avec sa famille restée au Canada. Il y avait d'autres choses qui n'étaient peut-être pas vitales, mais qui déchiraient littéralement, émotionnellement, cette relation familiale. Et je termine par l'autre texte, pour revenir un peu à mon obsession de George Floyd, de Lawrence Hill, que beaucoup connaissent, et qui, lui, pour faire court, nous rappelle tous les combats longtemps différés, mené sans succès, depuis les années 1921, de son père qui était évangéliste baptiste aux États-Unis. Ils ont fui la ségrégation, ils sont venus au Canada. Son père a créé la première commission canadienne des droits de la personne en Ontario. C'était un organisme pionnier en Amérique du Nord. Et quand il relate tous les combats, en évoquant une femme formidable qu'on retrouve sur le billet de 10 dollars aujourd'hui, hein, Viola Desmond, we have her now on our money. So, quand il évoque tout ça, et il termine par une phrase terrible qui nous interpelle tous. Il dit, c'est parce que toutes les générations d'avant n'ont pas mené ces combats que nous sommes obligés de le mener maintenant. Mais je pense que c'est exactement ce que nous ont dit tous ces jeunes, blancs, noirs, asiatiques, mexicains et autres, qui se sont levés à Minneapolis et ailleurs en pleine pandémie, en oubliant qu'ils pouvaient prendre des risques et prendre la maladie, en se levant en disant « Never again, nous voulons que ça s'arrête ». Donc je pense que cette combinaison de ces deux textes m'a beaucoup parlé et en même temps me donne de l'espoir pour le monde qui pourrait venir. Parce que si la jeunesse réussit enfin à prendre de face tous ces problèmes que nous avons longtemps mis sous les tapis, probablement que cet enfant-là, dont on ne sait pas trop qui il est exactement, le mien et tous les autres, bâtirons peut-être cet avenir que nous attendons.
Now, il y a des jours où he's Italian, sometimes.
Italian?
Yeah, sometimes Italian? Mexican, sometimes Italian.
So it's changed everybody personally. Is that fair? Has it made you a better writer?
It changed my writing, I think. I don't know if it made me a better writer, but it changed the issues I'm writing about. And it kind of, I think it kind of radicalized me in many ways. In being a feminist and being humanist and being having always a fighting spirit for an open society. And I don't know where this is really leading, will be leading me in the end, but I feel that there's a kind of transformation going on that I want to tell different stories and to rethink the structure of my writing. You know, with this world tumbling down, like this vanishing realities. I felt there was a big influence on the structure of writing, on the craft, on I'm stepping away from realism, I think, at the moment. And that was something, I was writing a novel during the pandemic. I started in March 2020 and I had to deliver like in October 2020. And while I was writing this, I noticed that, and these are crime novels, but realism stopped. It was going away. There was like magic realism suddenly in a crime novel. And after that, I thought, okay, I have to change my subject. I'm writing now in a different way, and this has to, yeah. It's still settling down. I don't know, but it did something, definitely.
Oh, it changed. It changed me in a sense that usually, you know, I'm always running around, traveling, and so on and so forth. So when during research. Yes, you do research, but you don't have time to have it sink in. Whereas the pandemic, because you're in one place, information has time to settle. Mm. And it was during the Black Lives Matter. And it hit me in such a way, you know, I was totally disturbed that I didn't know enough. You know, I was mad at myself for not knowing enough. And that brought me to the research for my own book, which was being written, and about the Vietnamese history, mm-hmm. how I didn't know enough. And I was too lazy to dig deeper. Mm-hmm. So it triggered, you know, that change in me. And the greatest change and the greatest chance as well was that I was at home with my children. So we have dinner together every night and I chatted with them about mm. what was happening. So we talked a lot about the different documentaries that we were watching so we could understand better with the Black Lives Matter and also the issues that I was looking into for my own book. So those discussions, I think, changed the book that I have written. Now, for the next one, I hope I will be able also to just stay home, have dinner with them every night because he's 21 now, my oldest one, so soon enough. Mm. You know, normally I don't have this opportunity, but right now, yeah, for this book and right now, I still have this opportunity. So he has changed me in the way that I write.
From what you've said, Blay, you weren't going to let COVID take your focus away. I'll still ask you if it's changed you as a writer, or maybe it's made you more determined to keep your focus, but.
Oui, absolument. Ça m'a poussé davantage à rester concentré comme écrivain en allant peut-être à ce qui pourrait être l'essentiel de choses. D'une part, parce que la pandémie nous a démontré, et pour moi qui viens d'un pays qu'on a présenté souvent comme un État failli, hein, pour de bonnes raisons d'ailleurs, me semble-t-il. Ça m'a montré les limites, en fait, des sociétés les mieux construites, hein, de voir comment tout l'Occident était complètement en panique, désemparé. Et ça m'a beaucoup fait réfléchir. Et ça s'arrivait à une période où je terminais mon roman qui vient de sortir, Dans le ventre du Congo, qui révisitait la relation entre le Congo et la Belgique. Mais au-delà de ça, du point de vue de l'expérience, d'être concentré sur l'essentiel, et ça va rejoindre peut-être ce que Kim disait, j'ai voulu aller chercher encore plus loin. Le roman précédent était un roman historique, d'aller voir dans notre histoire, dans ce que nous ne revisitons pas. Si ce que Raoul Peck disait, en reprenant le mot de James Baldwin, en disant « We bring our history with us, we are our history », si nous pensons que notre histoire, c'est quelque chose qui est séparé, nous nous trompons. Il dit même « We are criminal if we think that everything about history is aside ». Alors, je dis, ben, si tout ceci, finalement, comme les gens de Black Lives Matter le montrent, n'est que la répétition d'un cycle par lequel les humains n'apprennent pas de leur passé, donc ne suivent pas le conseil de Spinoza qui disait « Si vous voulez connaître le présent, étudiez votre passé », si cela est vrai, alors peut-être que comme écrivain, je devrais davantage m'intéresser aux ressorts historiques dont l'actualité pendant la pandémie nous a donné les fêlures les plus visibles. Et c'est ainsi que, face à plusieurs projets d'écriture que j'avais sous la main, ben, j'ai choisi celui qui, encore une fois, allait rechercher dans les angles morts de l'histoire du monde. Et c'est aussi pour ça que je suis en Allemagne, sans vous en dire plus, pour aller voir dans ce passé enfoui de deux côtés de l'Atlantique, qu'est-ce qui pourrait encore faire partie des saisies résolues, de ces coins que nous n'avons pas assez explorés par l'art pour peut-être nourrir encore nos discussions et aiguiser notre lentille quand nous voyons l'actualité revenir avec une impression de perpétuel recommencement. De ce point de vue, oui, l'influence sur mon travail est certaine et certainement dans le projet pour lequel je suis également en Allemagne et qui pourrait se terminer dans un livre à venir.
We know that COVID has changed literature, and it certainly has changed the Frankfurt Book Festival. Thus, Canada's here 2 years in a row. I think the industry's going to be stronger, that we're going to be able to have people write more books, more readers. Are you optimistic, in other words, post-pandemic for where we're going and why you're optimistic?
Because the numbers have shown that there's been an increase of 20% of books being sold. So I think maybe the pandemic has been very kind to books. I think maybe not to a festival or to for a book fair, but I think that people, you know, all of a sudden fell back onto books and try to find answers in books, strangely enough. Well, I guess we're already readers, so we already had this reflex, but for readers in general, and also time, you know, they had more time, and the pace was slower. So a book is the best, how would I say it in French, is ralentisseur de temps. It slows time down, right? And so, and maybe the pandemic reminded us that we can go at a different pace, at the pace of a book. And so, yeah, so I'm very optimistic. Maybe not I hope that book fairs will continue and will come back, of course, because it's an opportunity for us to meet with readers, and that's a great privilege for writers. But I think books now has a better position after the pandemic. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe my numbers are wrong. Don't listen to me.
Simon?
Yeah, I think especially this book shows in a beautiful way what literature is able to do. Because for me, as a German language speaker,
It was so beautiful. You know, my French is not perfect. I get maybe 60% of what you're saying. Even with reading French, with reading literature, it becomes more difficult. But to read a book from written by colleagues thousands of kilometers away, and we've done it all together, and to read your stories in English and French. So, as I said, I don't get like 50%, but it was a beautiful experience to see how what language, what literature can do. And it was especially your text, the rhythm, the sound, the atmosphere was so comfortable for me. So I really didn't get what it was Wait. About. Yeah, it was like a like
Waves.
Sitting on a very, very, very nice wave made of warm water. Like
Look at this.
And
we
yes.
have all these waves,
yeah, yeah.
right?
And
Traveling
that, you know, having this experience by myself, I strongly felt, okay, this is what literature can do, telling us we're all neighbors on this planet. And we're able, if we're not able to travel in real life, we can travel in our head and in our souls, and we can listen to each other and understand each other a bit better. And that's what literature is all about, I think. And my feeling is that the world got it a bit. So how important literature is, especially if you're caged into your house.
When I read the essays, the one line that stuck with me, probably because my background as a reporter, was that it seems like COVID was the only story in town. And I still feel that way when I watch the news most nights. It's still 70% or more of what's on the newscast. You think, will that influence what people are writing in general, or in a very general question, of course, or do you think yourselves and others will want to get away from COVID in what they write from here on in?
I don't think we talk about COVID. It's just that COVID had such an impact on everything. So we are under the impression that we only talk about the virus, but actually we're talking about all the changes that it has, you know, it has provoked, all the emotions that come out of this virus. And it's not about the virus at all. I don't think that we really talked about, you know, how it looked like. Well, now we know what it looks like because it's all over. But after that, you know, what happens once that the virus has hit, you know, all of us at the same time. And I think it's more about, the changes.
Yeah, and I think that's maybe part of our job that we are doing. We're the, you know, the society informed that was sitting around the log fire. Like, so, and there were always these freaks who had a special ability, not so good in chasing or something, but good in telling the group what happened to them and how it changes the group.
Yeah.
And
explaining almost the fear.
Explaining the fear, the damages, the wounds, and I think this is for storytellers, for writers, this is what our next 10, 20 years maybe is about.
We would know why people were so scared that they buy a lot of toilet paper. right? Because we still don't know why.
Yeah. In France, they bought red wine and condoms, I heard. It was not
condoms?
Toilet paper.
They
yes.
don't want babies?
Yeah, yeah. All over the world, it was toilet paper, but in France, they...
Vive la France!
Yeah.
Vive la France!
They know how to live.
En même temps, en France, il y a eu une étude qui a été menée, en tout cas, des sondages qui ont révélé que les gens ont fait moins l'amour pendant la pandémie qu'en temps normal, alors qu'ils étaient tout le temps enfermés à la maison. Donc peut-être que psychologiquement, ça peut casser la libido.
Oui.
Pour revenir à la création elle-même, je pense que quelque chose que le romancier, dans ce notre cas ici, peut-être aime aussi, c'est parfois prendre de la distance par rapport au temps, hein, sur les événements. Et tant qu'on est trop dedans, parce que la pandémie, on n'en est pas encore sorti. Peut-être que c'est un peu difficile aussi de prendre tous les contours et de produire des histoires toujours intéressantes et très pertinentes. Ça marche pour les uns, mais pour les autres, et c'est mon cas, je pense que on est trop dedans. J'ai trop les nez dans cette pandémie pour en faire vraiment de manière directe, hein, pas par les conséquences, les impacts comme Kim et Simone l'ont démontré, mais de manière directe, comme objet de création immédiat, je ne peux pas le faire. Je pense que pour moi, ça va prendre une certaine distance, en espérant que ça passe le plus rapidement possible. Ensuite, vraiment, peut-être avec le recul, en le regardant comme un objet distinct, je pourrais travailler dessus. Pour l'instant, je suis incapable vraiment d'aller de front dans une histoire qui parlera de ça. J'en ai presque jusque-là, voilà.
Thank you. Thank all three of you. Our time is up, and we appreciate all of you. And I had about another hour's questions, but I'm told our time is up. So thank all of you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes, I'm terribly sorry because I have the duty to remind us that time is not infinite. Just at the time when the stories were getting really interesting. But at the same time, I have the joy to ask Ambassador, Her Excellency Ambassador Sabine Aschbach-Wasser, Ambassador of Germany to Canada, to come and deliver the final remarks. Thank you very much, Your Excellency, chers auteurs, dear liebe Autorinnen, liebe Schriftstellerinnen. Schriftstellerinnen.
It's like an accident in the throat.
It's almost perfect. Danke sehr. Vielen Dank. Merci infiniment. Ambassador Spadacher.
Thank you, Jean.
I think it's perfectly fitting that Ambassador Stéphane Dion and I are the bookends to this event, because that's how we work together. The two of us always coming from both sides and pushing for the same great, I think, projects. And this is not always. And this is what our bilateral relation is all about. Let me tell you that for my team and me, this round table is really a dream come true. We're here, we're live, we're in person, and we are with our wonderful authors, with Kim Thuy, with Simone Buchholz, with Blaise Ndala. And I do hope, indeed, that this may be the beginning of a wonderful network of German-Canadian writers. This is exactly what my team and I had in mind, what we hoped and wanted to build when we started. We wanted to mirror Canada's amazing presentation at the book fair with a small bilateral project. But what we didn't even dream of was that we would have you, Your Excellency, here in the room with us. And we certainly didn't even dream of that your husband, Your Excellency Whit Fraser, author, storyteller of the highest order, would do the presentation. Thank you so much. Your warmth and your humor has made this all so very special. This roundtable, 20 on 2020, fits the narrative, if I may say that, of the state visit. It fits it remarkably well. It is about coming to terms with hard moments, with what were traumatic experiences, George Floyd, with fleeing your country, being a single mom and having to work, and the COVID pandemic altogether. And if I may add, Their Excellency in Berlin, in particular, have experienced and discussed the need to address what is painful, to understand it, and to recognize it in order to move forward as a society. We have seen during the visit and in the e-book discussion that Canada and Germany in this really are together. We're really united in the values that we bring to our past and to our problems. and that we can learn so much from each other and move forward, proud and enriched by what is the motto of this Canadian presence at the book fair, by our singular plurality embodied like nobody could do better by Her Excellency, the Governor General. Allow me a last point. We owe for this project a depth of gratitude to the Canadian Embassy, Stéphane, to Jean. We do owe the biggest depth of gratitude to Simon & Schuster, its president. Here he is, Kevin. Where's Kevin?
Here.
Kevin Hansen, his team. Editor Nita, but in particular, Janie Yoon, who has done all the hard work and did a great job. I want to say thank you to my team, to Christine Fortwängler, Michaela. I'm so sorry that Rosa Sokolowski is not here, but she did an amazing job. And I'm so pleased that Caroline from the wonderful Goethe Institute in Montreal, who has been so crucial, is here as well. So thank you all for the superb work that you've done. And if you allow me to dream again, then let's do this again. Thank you.
Okay, we have a rendezvous 4 days in 2040.